So this week we will be taking a quick look at the Shkadov Thruster, one of the simplest types of Dyson swarm to make, and a system for both moving things around the solar system and moving entire solar systems. This will be one of the shortest videos on the channel, which both ironically and non-coincidentally will be followed next week by the longest video to date on the channel. I'll talk about that a bit more at the end in a quick channel update. Here in the megastructural series, we'll be looking at Dyson spheres for a while, and there's a reason why I don't really consider them a megastructure in and of themselves, even though today's example could actually be built as one single rigid structure. As I mentioned in the Dyson Dilemma, the notion of any Dyson sphere as a rigid body has always been at odds with the original concept, which is a swarm of bodies orbiting the sun. These could vary from quite tiny objects individually, smaller than even modern satellites, to enormous structures, all with varying purposes, and to me a Dyson swarm is a megastructure the same way a metropolis is a building. Though you could build a single large city-sized building, often called an arcology, something we'll probably look at down the road. I tend to regard even a minimal early Dyson, basically one where you've hollowed out the asteroids in the asteroid belt to build solar collectors around the sun, and rotating habitats in those asteroids, as a Dyson sphere. You don't mine asteroids for planetary consumption, except maybe the very rare and precious metals as small but lucrative side businesses. You mine them to build other space-based industry, and a lot of times that will be very thin power collectors, either direct solar panels or mirrors. This gets us to the Shkadov Thruster because one of the most obvious applications of all those mirrors and panels is that the light can be concentrated to produce thrust on objects like spaceships, either direct thrust by pressure or by heating up gas inside them that gets expelled as rocket thrust. I've talked before about the concept of statites, ultra-thin satellites that can remain static in their location rather than orbiting, held up by radiation pressure. And this is a major portion of the Shkadov Thruster because this notion of moving solar systems usually comes up for moving your own, especially to avoid hazardous areas of the galaxy like near a potential supernova. But as we'll see in a bit, the better method is actually moving those giant stars that can go supernova. Now, a Shkadov Thruster itself is a really simple concept. Stars emit energy, both solar wind and light, but they do it omnidirectionally so they don't move. If just one hemisphere of the star was lit up, it would begin to accelerate in the opposite direction. This is worth remembering for more than the Shkadov Thruster because every object in space radiates energy, waste heat, and if you make it emit more in one direction than another, it will get thrust from that, meaning a lot of our megastructures can be made into very slow spaceships simply by slightly altering their geometry so they emit more light in one direction continuously. Photons, the particle of light, are nothing but momentum. They have no mass. So if an object is emitting asymmetrically, it will begin to have a net force on it equal to the emitted power divided by the speed of light, or an acceleration equal to the emitted power divided by the mass of the object and the speed of light. If we want to move a 1 kg object at 1g, normal Earth gravity, we can emit from that object, or let it absorb, 2.94 megawatts. Now, since we usually think of most space stations as being about room temperature, 300 Kelvin, they'd emit about 460 watts per square meter of exterior and probably weigh at least a ton per square meter, making for an acceleration of less than a billionth of a g, even if you can get it to be mostly asymmetric. This makes it a very crummy acceleration method, but possibly enough for station keeping, where you just need minor nudges. But you can get twice the thrust by using a mirror instead. A photon hitting and absorbing into something only gives you that one push. If it reflects off it, it doubles that push, since it moves away with the opposite momentum it hit with, meaning mirrors let you get twice the bang for your buck, or watt, and gives you 1.47 megawatts per kilogram of object as your 1g power need. That's what makes laser sails more attractive. You can hit something with a mirror on the back with concentrated light at a distance and give it a big boost to speed. And a real big boost to speed when you consider that the sun puts out 3.8 times 10 to the 26 watts of power, which means you could accelerate an object massing 1.3 times 10 to the 18th kilograms, or 1.3 billion megatons, at 1g constantly. And just one megaton makes for a very large ship. Alternatively, mirrors bouncing that sunlight can be quite small, tin foil thickness or less, quite possibly a lot less since some materials like graphene might only need to be a few atoms thick to make a nice mirror. And it could be very close to the sun without melting, especially since it's reflecting most of that light, not absorbing it. So you could get away with placing these mirrors where the sun is a lot brighter per square meter of reflecting material, and use less mirrors. A few tons of cheap mirrors could easily provide the light to accelerate a few tons of spaceship, and those spaceships don't have to move directly away from the mirror or sun, they can bounce that light to move at angles. You can also place mirrors farther out in the solar system, on or gravitationally anchored to heavy objects like planets, and reflect light off them and back into the system to let ships move toward the sun, not just away from it. So we get our first motivation for a simple early Dyson. Mirrors are cheap, especially super thin mirrors in space. You could make whole planet-sized ones out of a very small asteroid, and they're nothing but cheap thin material with a tiny computer and a bit of a mechanism to let you twist or distort the mirror. And if they're thin enough, we don't even need to put them into an orbit. They can just hover right over the star like a piece of paper over an air vent, using the light and solar wind to stay afloat. That's the concept of a statite, a static satellite, which I've discussed before. And the interesting thing about these is that their thickness doesn't depend on how far away they are from a star, since gravity, as well as light and solar wind, all fall off inverse square of distance. The same statite can hover in by Mercury or out by Jupiter. This thickness, linear density, of a statite varies by star, not distance, since bigger stars put out way more light and solar wind than smaller ones, and it rises a lot faster than gravity does. A star 10 times as massive as our own puts out 10 times the gravity, but several thousand times the light, for instance, letting you have a statite several hundred times heavier per unit area. You can also link statites together physically since they don't orbit. I render it graphically this way because it's easier, though you probably would never build a truly rigid sun-encompassing shell. You could, though. So ironically, the easiest Dyson to build, one of these thin-sheet statites, can be made as a rigid shell. Whereas normally, we consider that impossible for more substantial Dyson spheres. This doesn't take much mass, either. Even the smallest planet is more than sufficient, and it is unlikely there are many stars that don't have enough rocky material floating around them for this. Now, the Shkadov Thruster is the obvious, if extreme, application. We build a hemisphere, instead of a sphere, around a sun, and let the light bounce off it, pushing the sun. The mirrors stay in place because gravity holds them there. You could also do this with an orbiting swarm, by having those mirrors perpendicular on one side of the sun, and twist parallel to the light when they are in the direction you want to leave open, so the light passes by them unreflected. This approach has some advantages, in letting you build more robust objects, and better aim your light, too. And you also have a hybrid stage, objects that are still thin enough to get significant push from light, but too thick to be held up by it, which can have abnormally slow orbits for their distance from a sun, a concept not unlike Lagrange points, which can be very handy if you've got solar collectors you want to keep in line with Earth. Lagrange points work by causing a slightly faster or slower orbit around a primary body by the slight decrease or increase in gravity from a second body, and this is a similar concept, though by using light instead of secondary gravity. I don't think this object has a name yet, so I will tentatively coin the term lagites, as a hat tip to Lagrange points and lagging orbital periods. I also haven't seen any papers on the matter giving a serious detailed treatment, so that's probably fair game for any grad students or postdocs looking for a nice paper to knock out. Getting back to Shkadov thrusters, they are a fairly simple concept, but we have to ask ourselves why you'd build one. Because they're slow. You won't be able to reflect all that light, so using our straight non-bounce method probably gives us our best quick approximation, and the sun emits 3.8 times 10 to 26 watts. But it also masses 2 times 10 to the 30th kilograms. So pumping that into our equation gives us, ouch, 6.3 times 10 to the negative 13th meters per second squared. Okay, but stars live a long time, and a year is over 30 million seconds, so our delta V in a year is, 20 millionths of a meter per second. Okay, so it will take 50,000 years to get up to a meter a second, walking speed. But in 50 million years, that would be a kilometer per second, and that actually is a lot on the galactic scale, since those are the kind of timelines and speeds that will let you dodge stuff. Aim your star like you were trying to break orbit from the galaxy, and you could sail off eventually. Though we orbit the galactic core at about 200 kilometers a second, and that would be 10 billion years of thrust to get to those kind of delta Vs. Putting that in terms of distance, off from where you would have been otherwise, a million years will only get you about 0.036 light years away, or 13 light days, but that's enough to avoid dangerous approaches to other solar systems, and in 10 million years that would be 3.6 light years, and 100 million years, 360 light years, and a billion years, 36,000 light years, enough to be anywhere in the galaxy you want to be, with a full 10 billion year solar lifetime letting you cover 3.6 million light years, and trucking along at about 1,000th the speed of light. Honestly, not a great spaceship, but other stars live longer, right? Well, yes, but the problem is the longer-lived ones also put out way less power. A star half our sun's mass accelerates twice as fast from the same force, but only puts out 4% the power of our sun, so it will accelerate even slower, 8% as fast. But they do live a lot longer. So for instance, our neighbor, Bernard's star, would only accelerate at 2.4% the speed of our Sun, but it also ought to live a couple trillion years, so it might only accelerate at a 40th the speed, but it also gets to do it about 250 times longer, and end with about 6 times the velocity. But the other direction, more massive, works out pretty well. An O or B-type giant star, a potential supernova candidate, let's say good old Spica, 250 light-years away, outmasses our Sun by a factor of 10, meaning it needs 10 times the power for the same thrust, but also emits about 12,000 times as much power as our Sun. So it can pull off 1,200 times the acceleration. These kind of stars often only live a few million years, but after a million years of a Shkadov thruster, you could have moved it 1,200 times as far too, 43 light-years, 172 light-years in 2 million years, more than enough to get you out of your neighborhood. And Spica is only a B-type star, not a big O-type. You can shove those away much faster, especially since you can also bounce your solar wind out, not just your light, giving you more thrust. But here's the key concept. If you're afraid a supernova is going to hit your civilization in a million years, it's actually easier to move that star, not your own. Especially since you'd have to move all the solar systems you've colonized too, and there are thousands of normal stars you'd want to colonize for every supernova candidate in a given volume it would threaten. Now you might be thinking you'd want to direct that supernova candidate somewhere close but not too close, so you could harvest the metals it will make when it explodes. After all, a real Dyson, one thick with rotating habitats, not just a thin shell Shkadov thruster, takes a lot more metal than most solar systems have lying around. But honestly, it wouldn't likely be worth it, especially since one of the things you can do with all that energy from your swarm of thin solar collectors is some serious alchemy. I mentioned in the Dyson Dilemma video that while fusion of lighter elements into heavier ones is a nice way to gain power, but still beyond us even for the simplest hydrogen to helium transmutations, if you don't mind losing power in the process, you can make heavier elements much easier, and you would, after all, have a lot of power lying around to run your super colliders. We'll examine that more as we continue our look at Dyson spheres in future videos, but we'll stop here for today. The Shkadov thruster for moving stars, and its simpler version, simple thin solar collectors for sucking up energy or propelling spaceships around or out of your solar system, is where solar englobement begins. Next week, it's back to the Fermi Paradox to revisit the basics in what I'm dubbing the Fermi Paradox Compendium, as opposed to just Solutions 2.0. That was supposed to be ready this week, but then it is a remake of the previous record holder for longest video, and I thought it would be shorter. Unfortunately, there was a lot of material I wanted to cover, so it's got a runtime of 70 minutes, and only about a third of the video is actually done, which as these things go would make it about 70% complete. Usually researching, preparing, writing, and recording the script takes about half the time or less to make these videos. But that still meant doing this video was faster than finishing that one. I'm still deciding if I want to keep to a weekly release schedule, intermixing shorter and longer videos, or just fall back to an every other week schedule. We also have a poll this week for which of the selected topics you want me to hit next. The queue is very full of topics, but I'd appreciate knowing which you prefer I cover first. As always, questions and comments are welcome. If you're new to this channel, you can try out some of the other videos, and if you enjoyed the video, don't forget to like and share it. You can also subscribe to the channel for alerts when new videos come out. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.